My dear students, now I am going to start the quantum mechanics, and this is the next chapter within your module 4. And today basically we are going to see why quantum mechanics, what was the need of the quantum mechanics, and first let us see with some of the example, and then we'll look into a little more detail. All right, so let us suppose we were knowing that the Newtonian law was said to be absolute a law, that is we didn't have any violation of those law till late 18th century, but at the beginning of the 19th century we had many exceptions of the Newtonian mechanics, and therefore the Newtonian mechanics required to be reframed and little more sophistication was required in that theory. It does not mean that theory was wrong, but there was something which required to be added in that theory, and consequently Einstein came forward and he had added some concept in that, and that you are aware of about the special theory of relativity. So what is a law? Law is a statement which cannot be violated in any circumstances, right? Now let me introduce you with a small example where we can say the Newtonian mechanics failed and we require the new law to prove those classical mechanics, the example of the classical mechanics. Let us suppose we have taken a frame of the reference. So here is your frame of the reference that we have taken, right? In this frame of the reference, so this is your frame of reference. Let us suppose this is your stationary frame of the reference, and here we have any observer O who is standing, and we have another frame of the reference which is moving with a constant velocity, and that constant velocity is your V. V is the constant velocity with which this frame of the reference is moving. All right. In this moving frame of the reference, let us suppose we have placed two charge. One charge is your Q1, and parallel to this, let us suppose we have another charge. This is your Q2. These two charge is stationary in your this frame of the reference, and let us suppose this frame of the reference I have represented by O dash. Now this frame of the reference is moving with the velocity V, so with respect to the observer O dash, right, this charge, both the charge are stationary, both the charge Q1 and Q2 is stationary, but both the charge Q1 and Q2 are moving with a velocity V with respect to the observer O, right? So with respect to this observer, this frame of the reference, this frame of the reference, the another frame of reference is moving with a velocity V. So if it is moving with the velocity V, so here it does mean with respect to a stationary frame of the reference, these two charges are also moving. All right. Now let us see what these two observers is going to observe. The observer O dash will find these two charge is in the rest, because along with the observer, the charge is moving. So observer is also moving with the velocity V, and the charge is also moving with the velocity V. So both of them are in the rest with respect to each other. So what you will find, these two charge are repelling each other. So repulsive force is acting. So this is your repulsive force which is acting between the two charge. So a repulsive force is acting between the two charge. But what the observer O will see, here this is another observer who is also seeing these two charge. What he will find, these two charge are moving with the velocity V. So moment it is moving with the velocity V, it is going to constitute a current. So here we'll have the parallel current which is moving. So this is your current I1 and this is your current I2. So if you have the parallel current moving in the same direction, they will not attract each other, sorry, repel each other, they are going to attract each other. So what it does mean, the same charge which was repelling each other for the observer O dash is attracting each other for another observer O. It does mean this law has not been perfectly been explained using the Newtonian mechanics. So what I have applied, purely Newtonian mechanics I have applied, and what I am finding, the law of the thermodynamics is not getting satisfied using the Newtonian mechanics or classical mechanics, right? So that was this I have told you one example of your classical mechanics. So in the classical mechanics, what we are saying, everything is absolute, like length is absolute, velocity is absolute, time is absolute. So everything is absolute, these things can be. So he has given 5-6 absolute things, absolute dimension which cannot be changed in the any circumstances. But later on, we came to know through the Einstein theory of relativity that nothing is absolute, even time is not absolute. Time is also variable, right? And many experiments have been conducted with the help of the atomic watch. And if these two atomic watches are not in the rest, all those atomic watches were showing the different timings. So all these things have been experimentally observed, and experimentally it has been proven. So what we can say, nothing is absolute, and this has been experimentally observed, right? Now let's move further. So after the late of 18th century, we came to the study of your subatomic element, like we had the discovery of or invention of your electrons, right? J.J. Thomson has come forward with the discovery of your electrons, so, right? Similarly, we had some of the properties on the subatomic particle, like your Zeeman's effect, Stark effect, like those things. Similarly, later on, in the beginning of the 19th century, we had the black body radiations, right? And how does that black body radiation vary with the classical value of the radiation? And that led to the new physics, and that is called your quantum physics, or here we are calling as quantum mechanics. So let us briefly see this. What was the black body radiation, and how that black body radiation could not be satisfied classically, and then really why a new law was required, and that was introduced in a new concept. So a new dynamics was introduced, and that dynamics was called your quantum mechanics. So the first things comes out, what is a black body? So naturally, the black body, as all of you must be knowing, is a body which absorbs all the radiations which is falling on it, but it is not radiating anything, right? That is a black body. So let us suppose any object is looking blue. Why it is looking blue? Because it is absorbing all the colors, and it is radiating or reflecting only the blue color. That is, one particular wavelength is being emitted, and therefore it is looking blue. So any color is visible only because that color is being reflected from that body. So from, if we take the black body, it does mean nothing is being reflected from that, and therefore it is looking you like a black body. So let us, perfectly ideal black body is not possible, but let us try to make as close to as a black body. So what we are going to do, here we have taken a cavity which has very small opening, and on this cavity we have put a layer of black charcoal, right? So a layer, it is being filled with the black charcoal, right? So this entire portion has been filled with the black charcoal, right? And then again it has been enclosed. So again this surface has been blackened like this. This surface has also been blackened. This surface is also blackened. So what I'm saying, here we have got this type of the black body. So this is your perfectly black, close to the black body, right? Because this entire thing is blackened, right? Now this black body I am putting in an oven, right? So we have taken an oven, and in that oven we are putting this, and we have started heating this. All right, so what is happening, what we can say, see, radiation heat energy is coming inside through this cavity. It is coming inside, and of course it is going to be absorbed over here, because a black, even if there is a certain reflection from that, because perfectly black body is not possible, it will go to this wall. So here it will get reflected. If it is not getting reflected, completely absorbed over here, so with the reflection it will come to this wall, and it is going to be reflected. So any radiation which is coming inside this, like this, let us suppose this way it is coming, it should get absorbed over here. If it is not getting absorbed, it will get reflected, it will come to this wall, it will get absorbed over here. If it is not getting absorbed, it will come to this wall, it will get absorbed. So what I mean by this, any radiation which is coming inside this is getting absorbed, and it is not able to radiate anything, then that we are calling as a black body. So whatever the energy is coming to this, so this energy is getting absorbed by this. All right, but it has got its particular limit, the right of absorption. Now this black body has been removed from the oven, and we have kept out, and moment you are keeping it out, naturally what you will observe, you will find a energy is coming out from this, and the that I will explain you how the energy was coming from this. So that I'm going to take it later. So what we find, the energy spectrum which will be coming from this will have something like this type of the nature, where this is your wavelength, this is your wavelength lambda, this is your wavelength lambda, and this is your energy density or intensity of the radiation which is coming out. So what I am observing over here is, from this, as the wavelength is increasing, as you can see, wavelength is increasing. So if wavelength is increasing, it does mean its frequency is decreasing, right? And at one particular wavelength, we are getting the maximum value of the energy density coming out, right? So with the frequency here, with the wavelength lambda, what I'm observing, slowly this is increasing, then it is taking a peak value, and then again it is start decreasing, and this is called your black body spectra, right? So to explain this black body spectrum, a different group of the scientists came. It was not one particular scientist who has solved this, so I'm not going in the much detail of this. But finally, this entire spectrum, why we are getting this nature of the spectrum, was resolved by Planck's, and therefore we came to the Planck's law of radiation. Okay. To understand the basics of this, let me give you one example. Let's move with one example, and then we'll correlate that example with this diagram that I have plotted, and then I'm going to move forward, and then we'll see how the radiation is coming out. Now, the example that I'm going to give you is a very ancient example, where the people in the village were using the kiln to make their pottery items, right? So like your earthen items were being baked, so that because those days only the earthen items were used for the cooking, also for drinking, also for all the everything, for the worship also. So that earthen material was used, so that required to be firstly ripen inside the oven. Now, I don't know whether you have seen that. We people have seen our childhood in the villages. So if you can observe anywhere, still those things are going on, right? So there you have oven. Here, this is some type of the oven type of the things are there. And if you see there, you'll find a different type of the radiations will be coming out. Like you'll have the some part of this you'll find the blue color is there, some part of this you'll find yellow color is there, some part of this you'll find the red color is there, and then some part of that kiln you'll find the white color is coming out. So different colors will be visible inside the kiln, right? And that kiln will remain alive for maybe 2 days, 3 days, and this is how the earthen pot was used to be baked, right? To make it usable. Alright. Now here, what I'm telling you, what was the reason of getting the different colors, right? What are those reasons, and can we explain those colors? If we can really explain all those colors, we have explained the black body radiation, right? So exact the reason, if we are able to explain all the reason of the emission of all those colors, right? How it is coming, what is the standing wave, so all those things are hidden there, and if you are able to look into all these things, it does mean we have understood the black body radiations. All right, now we had taken in the previous chapter was your laser. In the laser, what we had done, that we had taken a resonator, right? So in the resonator, what we had the two mirrors, and both these mirrors were parallel, and one of the mirror was 100% reflecting and the mirror was partially reflecting, and there we had the two energy state. We had the two energy state with which we had seen the example, although we have the infinite number of the energy state, but two energy state we had taken, between which we had taken the stimulated emission. What I had told you there, that if the atom is coming from the excited energy state to the ground energy state like this, then photonic energy is being emitted. So this is the photonic energy which is being emitted, and this photonic energy is used to stimulate the other atom over here, and all the photonic energy is coming one particular direction. Now what is happening? All these photonic energy are moving to and fro within this, right? All those photonic energy are moving to and fro inside this, and inside this they are making a standing wave. So what do you mean by the standing wave? So here if I am taking, here I am taking, right, the resonators. So these are your two ends of the resonator. At the beginning and at the end, it must make the nodes. So if the wave is moving like this, if wave is moving like this, and again it is coming back, so here it has made the standing wave. So here it has made the, at the beginning it has made the nodes, at the end also it has made the nodes, and in between as many nodes are possible, it can be there. Now what we can find out there? Similarly, we can have other way. Here we can have maybe only one is possible. That is, it has started over here, it has started over here, and it has finished over here, right? So now what is the difference between the between this? Let us suppose this I am calling as the one, and let us suppose this I am calling as the two. So what is the difference? In this difference is, here you have this is the larger wavelength, right? And this is your smaller wavelength. This is your smaller wavelength. This is called your half of the wavelength. This is your lambda by 2. And this is equal to your lambda. Right? So what I am saying, this is your the wavelength is changing in the figure 1 and figure 2. If I am taking, the wavelength is changing, right? So as the number of modes are increasing, the wavelength is changing, right? Because of the, and wavelength is changing, it does mean its frequency is changing, and if the frequency is changing, it does mean its energy is changing. So what is happening? If they are, you are getting the different number of the standing wave, right? So some of the standing wave may contain higher value of the energy, some of them may contain the lower value of the energy. So within the kiln, right, if it is making the standing wave within this part, right, and here it is making the three modes, right, within this it is making the three nodes, right, it will have one particular value of the energy. But if it is coming over here, right, and within this it is making, let us suppose 10 modes, then here you will have the different value of the energy, right? Here you will have the different value of the energy, right? So in this way, here you, as you can see, so many modes are there. So each mode will be contained with a value of the energy k into t. Each of them will have the value of k into t. So 1, 2, 3, 4. So you just multiply all the this modes by the value of the energy k into t. So what, where t is the temperature, what you can find here, you have the more value of the energy. So this entire energy will be coming out from a black body. This is the cavity. So in exactly in the similar way, the energy is coming from here, right? And that energy is required to be scientifically explained, right? And if I'm going to put the energy that is coming from the kiln, and energy which is coming from your black body radiation, is exactly the same thing. Now you can imagine, this is an ancient thing, and this ancient thing could only be solved in the 19th century, right? So you can imagine how long it has taken to really prove those ancient theory, right? So now let us start to begin one by one, where was the problem and how the problem was solved, and then to solve those problems, how the new theory came. So this is what we are going to look into in this chapter. All right. So until the middle of the 19th century, the Newtonian mechanics based on the three laws of the motion was capable to explain all form of the physical observations of the material object, their characteristics and behavior that we know. That is all the material forms, right, were explained without any problem using the Newtonian mechanics, right? Then what we are saying, however, the development of technology, many new phenomena were observed for the explanation of which there were requirement of the refinement of the existing theory. So as just I given you the example that if I have put the two charge, right, in a frame of the reference, so two observer are both are in the stationary frame of the reference because one is stationary and other is moving with a velocity v. So both of them are the inertial frame of the reference. So there is no problem. Newtonian mechanics is completely valid in this frame of the reference, right? So what we observe that in one frame of the reference, for one observer, the two charges are repelling each other, but for the other two observers, it is attracting each other because it constituted the current. So the Newtonian mechanics require the refinement of the existing theory, right? That is the Galilean frame of the reference on which your Newtonian mechanics is based. It required revision. In the end of the 19th century, the exploration of the atomic system started with the discovery of the electron by J.J. Thomson and radioactivity by Henri Becquerel. So those theory also required to be explained. And of course, the Newtonian theory or the classical mechanics was not able to explain the phenomenon given by the J.J. Thomson or the Becquerel, right? So we require the refinement of that. Soon it was realized the classical mechanics do not give satisfactory explanation of the phenomenon with the subatomic physics. So moment we are coming to the atomic physics, subatomic physics, so we are not able to explain with all these phenomena, as I told you, the Siemens effect, the Stark effect, right? So these phenomena were not being covered or we are not able to explain using your classical mechanics. So refinement was required. All right, what next? In the theory of relativity, that negative result of the Michelson-Morley experiment led to the critically revised the Newtonian mechanics in terms of the special theory of relativity. Now, Michelson and Morley had done some of the experiment to find out the speed of the rotation of the Earth at the axis, right? So when he was doing his experiment, so of course he has applied the Galilean frame of the reference, that is the Newtonian's law, right? And the Newton has said that for moving any waves in the medium, or for any wave you require a medium, right? Then the question is, what about the light? Does the light also require a medium to travel? Newton has said yes, light also required a medium to travel, and that medium was called the ether medium. So in that ether medium, so-called the ether medium, Michelson and Morley had done his experiment, and when he did his experiment, he found that Earth is not moving at all because he was getting the negative result. Now it was not possible that Earth is not moving, right? Earth is definitely moving at its orbit, right? So this is called the negative result of Michelson and Morley. So Michelson Morley experiment, it was a very sensitive instrument, right? So even a very small changes, right, could have been detected by the Michelson Morley setup, and but it could not detect any observations, and therefore they came to know that something is required to be resolved in case of the Newtonian mechanics, and therefore we had a special theory of relativity, that is a new theory of relativity came, right? Newton's theory of relativity failed, and we came to the special theory of relativity, and using the special theory of relativity, this Michelson-Morley negative result was corrected. And what was that? Here we say the speed of the light is constant, right? So from this we came to the conclusion that really whatever the Einstein had said, that the speed of the light is constant, we came from here that we cannot take any relative motion with respect to speed of the light. So this is what was taken in case of the Michelson-Morley experiment. So if you are going against the ether or towards the ether, so you cannot take plus c plus b or c minus b, where v is the velocity of the light. Whether you are going against the ether or in the towards the ether, the velocity will remain c, and moment it was taken as c, then the Michelson-Morley experiment came correct, right? So this theory could not be explained using the using the Newtonian mechanics, right? And therefore we have the advent of the special theory of relativity. So what we are telling you, we require the refinement, right? Let us see further what the further refinement was required. Similarly, the experimental result on the intensity distribution of the black body radiation. So just I have explained you, the intensity distribution of the black body radiation could not be explained by the thermodynamics. So existing law of the thermodynamics, right, which that is called the classical electrodynamics theory. So using classical electrodynamics theory, we could not explain the curve that I had just shown you. That curve was not being explained using that theory. So what we required? A new theory was required to explain that curve, and that theory led to the quantum mechanics, the invent of the quantum mechanics. So let us see. The failure of the intensity distribution of the black body radiation led Max Planck to introduce the new concept of the quantum radiation, of quantum nature of radiation. So a new type of the radiation was introduced, and that is called quantum nature of radiation, and Max Planck is called as the father of the quantum mechanics, because that was the beginning of a new theory for such type of the events, or you can say for the subatomic particles. All right, so let us see what is the concept of black body radiation. So black body radiation is studied by looking at the heat inside a kiln. So just I had explained you in the previous slide how in the ancient time our people were using to wrap the earthen pots. Inside the kiln, there are electromagnetic radiation in form of the heat and light. All right. So inside that, so moment you are saying that you have the electromagnetic radiation, so naturally here, you, as you can see here, this is your big wavelength. This full is your lambda by 2, and this is your lambda by 2. So here this has decreased, this has further decreased. So what is happening? The wavelength is decreasing. The wavelength is decreasing. It does mean what is happening? Wavelength is decreasing. It does mean what is happening? Its radiation is, that is frequency is increasing, and therefore the total energy is increasing. So within the same cavity, this is one cavity only, within the same cavity, we are finding the different type of the standing wave. We are finding the different type of the standing wave. This is called your one harmonic. This is called the second harmonic. This is called your third harmonic, fourth harmonic, fifth harmonic, and so on. So what I'm telling you, as you are moving from the first harmonic to the second harmonic, third harmonic, fourth harmonic, what is happening? The energy is increasing within the same kiln. So inside the kiln, there are electromagnetic radiation in form of the heat and light, right? So all of them will be giving you in the form of the heat and light. Maybe initially you are getting the ultraviolet, right? Then you are coming to the infrared, and then you are coming in the form of the visible spectrum also. So entire part of the electromagnetic spectrum will be there. These existed as standing waves. So what is the standing wave? If they are forming the nodes at the end of the kiln, then that we call the standing wave. So all of them, as you can see, are forming the standing wave, right? At the end, it is making the nodes, and that will call your standing wave. All right. So it is just like your guitars. So if you are plugging the string of the guitars, so it will be making you some standing wave, right? So just you can imagine with that example, it is exactly like your guitar. Okay. So then it is pretty pretty reasonable to conclude that there are many standing waves with a lot of the different wavelength inside the kiln, right? And hence the different colors. So as I have told you, right? So what we have seen in that figure, previous diagram, that you are getting the different type of the wavelength within the same kiln. So therefore, at the low temperature, the kiln emits the infrared spectrum, right? We increase the temperature, then it glows to red. So slowly it is changing the temperature, and therefore as it is changing the temperature, its color is also changing. Increase the temperature more, it glows to orange. Increase further, increase it even more, then it will become yellow. And again you increase, it will become bluish white, and that is also called white hot. Bluish white, and that you will call the white hot, and that is the last part of your visible spectrum. It does not mean that beyond that you don't have, beyond that also you have. All right. The higher the energy of the standing wave, the shorter or the smaller the wavelength. So naturally you have seen. So as we were moving from the top to bottom, first harmonic, second harmonic, third harmonic, fourth harmonic, the wavelength was decreasing and naturally the frequency was increasing. So you can go back to your previous slide and you can see there. All right. As we go towards the ultraviolet, that is the smaller wavelength and the higher frequency, we have the higher temperature. So as you are going towards more and more shorter wavelength, naturally the temperature is increasing, and here you will not be able to see the colors because you have already gone beyond your visible spectrum. The classical statical mechanics tell us that average energy of a standing wave will have the energy equal to k into t. So one standing wave will have the value k into t 2. So double kt 3. So if you have the n, then you have the n kt. So we can say that there is more energy at the higher temperature. So naturally, because the number of the standing wave is increasing, and so naturally you are going to get the more value of the energy, and of course the temperature is increasing. All right. So now looking this, those experiment of the curve. Now I am coming with the formal introduction of that curve. And this is your curve that was taken up. Now, as you can see over here, this x-axis has been taken with respect to the wavelength, right? So it is your reciprocal of your frequency. So if the wavelength is increasing, it does mean its frequency is decreasing. All right. And this is your in total intensity, which is coming out. And here the small part you will be able to see, and this is called your visible spectrum. Other part of that you will not be able to see, right? So you have the higher temperature beyond that. All right. Now what we are saying, the black body radiation curve shows that black body does radiate energy at every wavelength. So as you can see from here, minimum to maximum, you have you are getting the energy at all the wavelength. So this is your first observation from this black body radiation. So what was the experiment that has been taken? So same the things that I told you, a black cavity has been taken, and that cavity has been placed inside the oven, and then from that oven it has been taken out, and then it has been left out for cooling, and it's whatever the intensity is coming out with this, that intensity is being studied, and this is the nature of the curve that has been observed, right? So what is the first observation is that we are getting some value of the intensity at all the wavelength, because as you can see over here, this wavelength is not touching your x-axis. So it is going to meet at the infinity, right? So up to the maximum value of the wavelength, you have some value of the energy. What next we are saying? The curve gets infinitely close to x-axis but never touches it. The curve touches at infinite wavelength. So till infinite wavelength, you are getting some value of the energy. All right. And that is your electromagnetic spectrum. So this led to the value, your electromagnetic spectrum, and on which your entire communication is dependent, right? It also shows that black body emits at a peak wavelength at which most of the radiant energy is emitted, right? So naturally at you are getting some peak wavelength. So this is your peak wavelength at all the temperature. You see, this is your 2000 Kelvin. This is your 1750 Kelvin, 1500 Kelvin, 1250 Kelvin. So this is one particular wavelength at which most of your most of the temperature the energy is getting emitted, right? So this will call your peak wavelength. So at one particular wavelength, for all value of the temperature, you are getting the maximum value of the energy. This is what it means. It shows that black body emit at the peak wavelength. So this is one particular peak wavelength, maybe between 2 to 3 micrometer, at which most of the radiant energy is emitted, right? And then as you are going away, it is decreasing. All right, let's move further. at each temperature, the black body emits a standard amount of the energy. So as you can see, so at 2000 Kelvin, so if you take the total area under this curve, so this is the total energy which is being emitted. So to find out the total energy, what you require to do, you require to take the energy of the entire curve. So you take the energy of the entire curve from beginning to here. So entire energy you take, right? So this is your total energy which is being explained. So what we can say, this is your total energy, right? So area under this curve, whatever the area is coming under this curve, that will be your total energy emitted at that particular temperature. All right. Similarly, if you are, let us suppose we are going to the next temperature. So next temperature is your 7050 Kelvin here. So now you take an area under this curve. So this is your total energy which is being emitted. So at the different temperature, what you are finding, you are getting the different value of the total energy which is getting emitted. So that is the other observation of this black body radiation. Next one. All right. Now those observations, as I told you, could not solve for a very long time. And there were the group of the scientists at a different interval of the time with a different group of the scientists. It was attempted, but finally Planck put all of them together and he was able to solve this myth. So in 1900, Planck succeeded in developing a theory that correctly predicts the frequency distribution of the thermal radiation for black body. And so he had made certain observations, and based on that observations, which we call the postulates, he was able to prove that. And what are those postulates? Some of these postulates you are familiar with, because we had something of that we had also discussed in the chapter of the laser. Now let us see the first one. Each of the atom of the black body vibrate at its mean position, called the atomic oscillator. The atomic oscillator in a body cannot have any arbitrary amount of the energy. They could have only the discrete energy, a discrete unit of the energy given by E equal to nh nu. What it does mean? What I told you, that this is your cavity. This is your cavity, and each part of this cavity is from all part of this, some atoms will be coming out. From each part of this, some atom is coming. Some atoms are there, and each part the atom is vibrating. At each part, the atom is vibrating, right? So it is just like your atomic oscillator, right? So the atoms are vibrating at its mean frequency at all the points of this, right? And which that we are calling as atomic oscillator. Naturally, as it is oscillating, it is going to emit the energy, but it is not going to emit the energy in any fraction, right? It is going to emit the energy only when it is able to create a standing wave between this wall to this wall. So either you can have this type of the wave, right? You will have this type of the wave, or you can have this type of the wave. That is, it must be your standing wave. At the end, you must have the nodes. That is here also at the beginning, and at the end you must have the nodes, then you will have only the standing wave. So you cannot have the arbitrary amount of the energy which is being released by the oscillators. So a fixed value of the energy is being released by this oscillator, right? And this value of the energy is called E equal to nh nu, right? So it is going to, where n is the positive integers and nu is the frequency of the oscillations and h is the Planck's constant. So depending upon what is the frequency of the oscillations, right? So here, as you can see, if you have the two nodes or three nodes or four nodes, depending upon that, the frequency is changing. So depending upon the frequency of that, you have the different value of the energy which is being emitted. All right. So this is the first law. So what we are saying, the energy from this atom cannot be emitted randomly. It can be only emitted in a fixed unit. All right. Let's move to the next one. The atomic oscillator cannot absorb or emit the energy, all right, randomly. So let me delete this. What I am saying now, the atomic oscillator cannot absorb or emit energy of any arbitrary amount. They absorb or emit the energy in the discrete unit. The amount of the radiant energy in each unit is called the quantum of energy, and each quantum carries an energy equal to h nu. So what we mean by this, that here you are forming one packet. So this is your one standing wave. So this is your one packet. Then this is your second packet. This is your second packet. So the standing wave which is being created are in the form of the packets, right? So when the atom is coming from higher energy state to lower energy state, then it is going to emit the energy. So if it is coming higher to lower, it is going to emit the energy, and it is going to emit the energy only when it is going to take up this form. Whether it is taking the one standing wave or two standing wave or three standing wave, but it must be the multiple of that standing wave. In such a way that the value of the each packet must be same. So you can have the two packets, three packets, four packets, or one packet, right? You cannot have the 3.5 packet, 4.5 packets of the energy cannot be emitted. So energy will be emitted if it is coming from the excited state to ground state only when the packet is full, and that smallest packet is called h nu. That smallest packet is containing with the energy which is directly proportional to your frequency, and that is your nu, and that proportionality constant is your Planck's constant, and that is your call h. So E equal to h nu. Similarly, if the atom is going from the ground energy to the excited state, it will absorb the energy, right, in form of h nu, and then only it is going to go there. It's not that in halfway it will stop. Let us suppose it requires four packets of the energy. First you will have to provide four packets of the energy, then only it will start moving up. It does not mean 3.5 packet you are given, it has gone some distance, it will stop there, right? And then again you provide another half packet, and then it will go. It does not work like this. Firstly, you will have to provide all the four packets if it required, and that the smallest packet is called your quanta, right? And that is your smallest value of the energy, and that smallest value of the energy is called quantum, right? So this is your second postulate. The energy of each quantum is minimum amount of the energy that can be found separately and cannot be further subdivided. So E equal to h nu cannot be further subdivided. As I told you, it cannot be fraction, it cannot be half, it cannot be 3.5. You cannot subdivide it. It represents the smallest quantity of energy of radiation of that frequency. So at that frequency, that is your smallest value. Yes, it is dependent of the frequency. So packet is formed with the frequency. So it is dependent on the frequency, but it cannot be 3.5, 4.5, 5.5. It will be directly proportional to your frequency, and value of the frequency must be in multiple of n, where n is your the value from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, like this, right? Okay, the atoms absorb or emit energy by jumping from one quantum state to another state indicate that energy cannot energy content of the wave is related to the frequency of wave rather than the square of the amplitude. So square of the amplitude as postulated in the classical wave theory. So classical wave theory, what we say, the energy emitted is directly proportional to the square of the amplitude. So if a wave is, let us suppose if atom is vibrating, let us suppose this is your amplitude, this is your amplitude, and this amplitude we are calling as A. So according to your classical theory, the intensity will be square of your amplitude. So intensity will be a square of the amplitude, right? This is your classical theory. But now we don't say this. What we say, it is directly proportional to the frequency. With what frequency it is going to oscillate? So energy is directly proportional to the frequency. It is not directly proportional to the square of the amplitude. So here the classical wave theory, right, fails to explain the black body radiation, because we are using the square of the amplitude, right? And therefore it fails. So what is the new theory? What is the crust of the new theory? That the energy is being that is being released is directly proportional to your frequency, not the square of the amplitude. Okay. Let's move further. So these were your postulates. Based on these postulates, the Planck's was, and of course combining of the, some of the existing theory, the Planck's was able to give some of the theory, and those theory come in this form. E lambda, that is as per the wavelength, how does the energy density which is varying is coming out. So this I have taken with respect to wavelength. The mathematical calculation I have not taken, which is the beyond the your level. So the total energy density at one particular value of the wavelength, that is how it is going to depend upon the wavelength, is given by 8 pi sc d lambda upon lambda to the power 4 into exponential sc upon lambda kt minus 1. This is the total energy coming and it is dependent upon the wavelength lambda. Now same thing, let us calculate on in terms of the frequency. So this same equation has been converted in terms of the frequency, right? That is E equal to h nu is equal to sc upon lambda, E equal to h nu and h nu equal to hc upon lambda. So that is what I have applied. And so if we have taken in terms of that, nu is equal to c upon lambda, I have applied. So wherever you have the nu, right, you apply c upon lambda, right, and I have, it has been converted. So in terms of the frequency, the total energy that is coming out will equal to 8 pi h nu cube by c cube delta nu upon e to power h nu upon kt minus 1. This will be the value of the total energy density which is coming out from a black body radiation at one particular frequency. So this is your frequency dependent, this is your wavelength dependent. Of course they are the same thing, only the frequency has been converted into the wavelength, or the wavelength has been converted into the frequency, right? And this is why I had used this radiation, right, total radiation in your laser, because in the laser also you had taken your atomic oscillator, right? So resonator is nothing, this is just like your atomic oscillator, and this your black body is nothing, it is your atomic oscillator, right? So this value of the total energy density, whatever we are getting in case of your black body radiation, that is resonator, has been equated with your optical cavity, right? Where here k that you are seeing here in the both the things, here also you have the k, is your, here also you have the k. So k is your Boltzmann constant, the value of which is constant, 1.38 into 10 power minus 23 joule per kelvin. T is the absolute temperature, c is the velocity of the light, right? So this equation gives the radiation energy density per unit frequency at the frequency delta nu. So in this way, my friends, I have just given you the brief introduction that why we require the quantum mechanics, what was the difficulty in the classical mechanics that required to be resolved. So I hope bit of this you must have explained what is the requirement of the quantum mechanics. Now from the next class, systematically I am going to start with your syllabus, that is with your uncertainty principle. But here, according to your syllabus, Planck's constant is the part of your syllabus. Thank you very much.